This episode of The Construction Record is brought to you by the Ontario Sewer and Water Main Construction Association. Clean water is everybody's business.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 81 of the Construction Record podcast. This is Vince Versace, National Managing Editor of the DCN and JOC, joining you today. And with me, I have, across the country,
Digital Media Editor Warren Fry.
And Staff Writer Russell Hickson.
Hey, guys. So 2 weeks ago, we did our first podcast from our respective homes. Our pandemic chronicles, let's call them. Or quarantine chronicles.
Our bunkers.
Yes, from our respective bunkers in Ontario and BC. And when we talked last week, it was about the initial response of kind of the industry to what was unfolding around them, around the COVID-19 pandemic. But also the crux of a majority of our discussion was the question that was out there amongst our stakeholders, our readers, and our subscribers, which was, how essential is construction in the middle of a pandemic? And needless to say, like, we've seen a lot change and a lot not change since 2 weeks ago when we talked about it, right? So where are we at right now with BC as far as the essentiality of construction?
Well, I'll say several things. I mean, first of all, it seems like the cases of COVID-19 in BC are not increasing exponentially. We're averaging like something like 40 to 50 to, you know, rarely 60 or 70 cases a day. And it's not really going up beyond that. So we're not seeing like this explosive growth of the virus in BC. And so they haven't really changed. And we also haven't seen a massive major outbreak on a construction site. And so they've essentially told the builders, if you can follow these guidelines, if you can maintain social distance, have these hand washing stations, the signage, et cetera, and still complete your work, you can do that. And so, I mean, some sites maybe you can't, but, you know, some sites you can. And so, you know, some construction has been plugging away in BC. And they, I think a lot of sites have definitely, you know, reduced their workforce on the site to, you know, less than 50 people at a time. But, you know, there's still a lot of work going on.
Warren, from what you've been looking at and coming across...
Well, this is less BC and more Alberta, but I was attending virtually the CAP, Canadian Association of Petroleum Producers conference last week, and there was a ton of stuff to come out of that. One of the things was I've got one article that's going up and one that's already gone up about different producers, and what they were saying is the way they build kind of lends itself to social isolation in the first place because it's remote and they can space things out and it might take longer, but they can still do what they have to do. Also, a lot of this kind of their construction is either in the winter or it's in the summer, and it's not really in the spring because they've got to deal with the thaw and wait for that to happen or have it not happening, one of the two. And so this is kind of their fallow period as far as building goes. So they can withdraw now, and those that can work remotely are already working remotely. So according to them, they're doing okay in terms of social distancing, and they are, if anybody, is considered essential work, right? So
it's interesting that you'd mention that, Warren, because just today it was announced by Alberta that three people have tested positive for COVID-19 at Imperial Oil's Curl Lake oil sands project, and then they're isolating six others, and that's about 70 kilometers from Fort McMurray. So you know, just a few weeks ago we had people saying, you know, we need guidelines for people in industrial sites to keep these workers safe on these remote kind of work camp areas. And, you know, just a few weeks later, you know, this is just kind of breaking, you know, yesterday and today, we are starting to see, some of these cases at these remote work sites. So I don't know, things could rapidly change in the next few days as to if these sites can remain safe or not.
It's kind of like the work is relatively safe, or at least relatively safe in terms of COVID, but then they got to stay somewhere, and then that's where you have a problem, right?
I mean, they can say that, but again, we're starting to see our first, you know, infections at one of these work camps.
True.
Interesting. Yeah, like, I mean, here in Ontario, BC's been held up as an example of how construction can continue in a pandemic amongst some of the stakeholders, more in the residential sector. Here in Ontario, we've heard that. It's like, look, we look at the way BC is operating. It's fair. It's measured. You know what I mean? The rules are set up in place. We can replicate that here in Ontario. Ontario and Quebec have been the two provinces that are pretty unique in their response to how to keep the construction industry going during the pandemic, as we're finding. Because pretty much everywhere else is kind of business as usual, maintain your social distancing, put in your cleaning stations, your water stations, and go ahead. Whereas Ontario, we have a bit of a hybrid. Like just recently, the premier was talking about, yes, certain construction is essential. And it seemed like everything was wrapped up in those initial comments, which were then revisited last week. And the province introduced accelerated construction, which at first we understood to be just accelerated construction around key infrastructure, key transportation projects, key in the end medical projects like hospitals or anything that would be servicing for hospitals. That's initially what we thought. So the accelerated construction was meant like construction 24 hours a day on anything that was healthcare related. Essentially, that's what it meant. Oh. But then we started to realize in the week since, it's like, hey, hold on. It's not just about healthcare projects. It's actually pretty much any other type of project, like any type of condo residential project now has noise bylaw exemptions. They're not necessarily 24 hours a day, but they can work later into the evening, those projects. Because they're of the belief, as they are in some other jurisdictions in Canada, that there are people waiting for homes. Then some of these homes, you know, were ready to be occupied by June, July. You're leaving people in the lurch. So get on site and start completing those projects. Some people in the industry here, too, as well, are more the home builders and some of the key GCs were saying, you know, because here in Ontario, when they kind of announce, you know, all construction is pretty much closed except the ones that are on the essential list, they gave a 1 day warning. So we have people in the industry going, you can't shut down a project site in 24 hours and make it safe. You know, with the homes, you need to waterproof them or else it's all spoiled, it get rotten. Like, we need a bit more runway to complete some of these projects properly before you shut them down. And it's very interesting. In Quebec, just yesterday, they were the first one to shut down everything completely, pretty much. And as of yesterday, they announced that on the 20th of April, certain residential construction projects can resume. Ones that have certain occupancy completion dates can now get up and running. And the supporting construction services like landscaping and stuff that go with those type of projects can now also engage. So it's interesting, right? Every jurisdiction seems to be maybe a little different, but maybe not as much. And now you wonder, Russ, to your point, here you got your first work camp where there's a bit of a breakout going on.
Yes.
What happens, right?
Well, there was a lot of talk before that breakout. This is exactly what people were afraid of. You have all these guys, you know, who knows where they're flying from. Well, I guess they're flying from parts of Canada. And they just saw it as like a, you know, a recipe for disaster. And I mean, who knows what's going to happen with this outbreak? They may be able to stop it, isolate it, and it's not a big deal. Or this may spur them to put in stricter controls or shut down work camps altogether. Who knows? Who knows what's going to happen in the next, you know, 48, 72 hours?
What's that?
Yeah.
It's interesting. Hey, I was saying for our listeners and our readers, I was mentioning how I'm really impressed when I look at the BC stakeholders, industry stakeholders. We're talking from owners to labor to safety, how they've kind of rallied during this pandemic. You could probably give us a bit more insight on that, Russ.
Yeah, I was talking to Dave Bispalli from the Council of Construction Associations the other day, and he kind of walked me through the timeline of what happened. Because we had kind of the week of just like the shock week, where it's just like we had business as usual and then just this massive, you know, shock wave of completely changing on a dime. And now that we're starting to kind of catch up to the new reality, he was being a bit reflective, and he said, you know, pretty quickly all the associations and major stakeholders in BC kind of got together. And you know, in the past, you know, especially with, you know, certain hot button issues like the CBA and just labor issues, you know, they're very contentious and they're very public about disagreeing with each other. But when it came to this, they all kind of were on the same page of workers first. If workers aren't safe, we don't work. That's it. Bottom line. If we can't keep workers safe, then we can't operate. And so they sat down and got together and said, how can we create environments that workers are safe, that they can follow, you know, these guidelines? And they all have their different kind of specialties. And they kind of specialized in and did that. And COCA, they set up their help desk, and you know, they have a very close relationship with WorkSafe BC and were able to get rapid answers like within just a few hours of these complex questions of people asking, you know, what if I have to drive in a car across a construction site with somebody, you know, what qualifies as a wash station, and different tech, really, you know, noodly technical questions that, you know, it could take forever to get a, you know, a confirmation from WorkSafe BC. So they've been doing that. And then you had, you know, the BC Construction Safety Association with Mike McKenna, and they're kind of compiling all these best practices and, you know, creating this large database of information for people to access, you know, especially smaller companies that maybe don't have the staff or the budget to, you know, get all this information that a lot of companies in BC, which this information would normally be proprietary, have waived that. They said, we don't care. And it's just been really interesting. And Dave, you know, Dave Bispali said he was just super proud of the whole industry in BC, how they've just kind of put aside politics and put aside, you know, kind of the siloing that, you know, can sometimes happen. And they've really come together. And, you know, they're not really sure why the cases in BC are really low, because, you know, a lot of other provinces and places are doing, you know, similar social distancing measures. But for whatever reason, this is probably going to be studied for years. We seem to be doing pretty okay for the time being.
Well, you see the news reporting, and they talk about the kind of the integrated kind of health sector, which I can't speak with any authority on, you know, right. What I mean, in BC. But what I see reported primarily in CBC, they were talking about how in BC, it's kind of the integrated nature of the health system there, the health industry, that's kind of, they think, is one of the reasons why. And you know, we're not here to talk about that and debate that on the podcast, right? But it is going to be something that's studied, right?
Like, so I think now, so there used to be a lot of questions about how do we socially distance, a lot of technical questions. And now that I think a lot of companies have caught up with those questions, the questions that they're getting are, okay, now that we're doing this, how does business look going forward? And how does reopening the economy, how does generating the economy start to happen in the next, you know, few months or half a year, however long this takes, what's our plan for that? So now people are less in the shock phase, and they're more kind of looking ahead and looking for some form of certainty about how can we start to plan for construction in this new reality? How can we start to maybe think of ways to work around this? And you know, we'll see what sort of solutions and things people come up with.
Yeah, like it's funny you use the word shock. And Warren, I was thinking about you with that CAP symposium. Shock, when you look at what's happened in Alberta, talk about the three-headed monster, right? Pandemic, early global recession, crashing oil prices.
Yeah.
Right? So you actually sat in on that symposium, and Jason Kenney talked, the premier of that province.
Yeah.
Why don't you take us through that flavor of the shock and how they're trying to contextualize it all?
One of the interesting things, they had a panel, and it was full of guys who were kind of, who've been seeing it all before, and then a few who are like newer, quote unquote, as far as this goes. Like, one guy had basically started talking about the National Energy Program, and he said all of that and all the stuff we had to deal with, and the fact that America became an oil producer and not, you know, an oil importer, all that taught us to, quote unquote, expect the unexpected. So not that they expected this, but they are a little more prepared than they would have been otherwise to withstand all this stuff. So they say, like, we'll see. We'll see how many oil companies survive this whole thing, and then for sure what that. But they seem to say, yeah, the nature of our business is this kind of up and down thing. So we kind of didn't see this coming, but definitely are prepared for it. Although another, I can't remember which guy in particular, it's in the article, said, well, we've already been paring back, so how much more fat can we get rid of? There isn't that much left, and I'm like, that's also a fair point.
Well, the recent recession already kind of trimmed that fat, right? In the last 2 or 3 years.
It's incredible. It's that, and that's why, unrelated to construction, it was a pretty good feel-good story a couple of days ago when Alberta, there it is, and despite everything that it's endured, through their procurement processes and pre-planning for the pandemic, they have this incredible surplus of masks and surgical PPEs and equipment.
Yeah.
And they have space in their beds. The pandemic hasn't taken hold as heavily as they would have thought. And here they are helping out Ontario and Quebec.
Yeah.
You know, unrelated to the oil, but all that, but it's still all the same. Here's a province that's really getting its butt kicked. right?
Economically, yeah.
Economically, but in the end, because of good planning and good forethought and good foresight, like, here they are helping out two of the other bigger provinces in Canada, right, that are just struggling to keep their frontline workers in proper equipment.
And Alberta has had some major high-profile disputes with BC in the past, you know, few years.
Right.
Like, really ugly disputes, public ugly disputes about, you know, trade.
Yeah, like not taking BC wine and
Yeah,
to be fair, that was the previous administration, but
threatening to turn off the taps and all this stuff.
Right, and here you are, right? I know it's impressive. It's funny when you were talking there, Russ, just a little while ago about business as usual and the shock week.
Yeah,
like we saw that with Ontario here, and what amazed me, and I don't care if it's editorializing, right? It's like the shock week was there. But then the business-minded side of it kind of felt like everybody's well-intentioned. And I know I'm being a cynical journalist, right?
Right.
But for us, the political divides that kind of disappeared there in BC, in a way we haven't seen them here. Mm. You know what I mean? You got kind of competing employer groups, competing groups kind of trying to take credit for stuff because they're the ones that are supposed to have the ear of the minister so they can prove it to their members. Mm. You know, you got people out there. They're all in the end trying to do the best for the industry. Yes, I believe that. Do the best for workers. Sure. I believe it too. Right. But I'm still back to what we talked about 2 weeks ago when the three of us together were speaking, and it hasn't stopped. The commentary from guys on the ground. Right. Mm-hmm. That are sharing stories with us and sharing stories now with our reporters, mm-hmm. you know, is that some of the stuff is not getting taken seriously around the social distancing and providing hand washing stations. Some guys have really stepped up. Some companies really have. But we're hearing stories and getting photos sent to us. It's like, look, does this count as a hand washing station? And it's a hose with a sign that says bring your own soap.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, now we have to independently verify that. Like, if we were TMZ, we'd be running with that already, right?
TMZ, you know, thankfully.
But we're not. You know, the DC and JOC are not. Believe it or not, those of you that are sometimes you think we are, but we're not, right? But that's the type of stuff that's kind of coming across my inbox, right? And it's because it's this fight between labor and owners. That line is there. Once the shock and awe week, to borrow that term, went by, it was like people went back to their corners pretty quick. You know what I mean? And I found that interesting. You know what I mean? It's like, you're kind of hearing that. And it's like, yes, everybody has the ultimate goal that everybody wants to be home, say, get everybody home safe. But the business side of construction really has reared its head really quick. Like, for instance, we have lawyers already commenting on guidelines that are getting put forward by the ministry. You know what I mean? Kind of, it's already at that level. It's like, well, look, yeah, our chief prevention officer here in Ontario has released these guidelines for COVID-19 prevention on sites. But you have the legal community kind of going, yeah, that's good, but it's not sacrosanct. Yeah, that's good, but you got to do a bit more research. Or, yeah, call a lawyer.
They're already trying to poke holes in it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right? And it's like, well, isn't that interesting? You know what I mean? How quickly that's happened just in the 2 weeks since three of us spoke.
Wow.
You know what I mean? That cycle, as I've seen it here in this jurisdiction, in this area here, right? So.
Well, you've had in BC, I was talking to Best Pally, and he said, you know, they're also getting calls of people shaming employers who are not following the guidelines. They're kind of, you know, publicly shaming each other. And he says, and he essentially said, good. He's like, if you're not going to follow the guidelines, you shouldn't have a site open. Shame on you. Like, so that's kind of the attitude in BC, which is they're just very, very worker focused right now. And it hasn't really changed. And I haven't heard a peep about kind of the classic kind of labor versus owners and employers, you know, stuff. I really haven't heard any of that.
And it's funny, you mentioned exactly that term when I read your story when that was filed. And today in my inbox from one of the leading kind of OH&S lawyers here in Ontario, I get this idea pitched to me, which will be an op-ed that will be running soon, was basically the guy saying, look, Vince, the Ministry of Labor's naming and shaming of contractors is illegal. It contravenes the OHSA, the Ontario Occupational Health and Safety Act, and is manifestly unfair. You know what I mean? So talk about what a difference, because I read your piece that shows up in my inbox, a completely different jurisdiction, different province. It's like, wow.
In BC, they're like, shame on you. Shame on you. How dare you put workers in danger? That's kind of the attitude here, is how dare you put workers in danger if you're in your... And also, I think there's an attitude of like, don't ruin it for us. We've been given the privilege of being allowed to continue working.
Yeah.
And if somebody blows it for everybody, then... a lot of people are going to lose work. And I think that's also, you know, it's kind of a mutually beneficial thing, where it's like, you could, if we can keep workers safe, and also we get to keep working. And I don't think nobody wants someone to ruin that for them. And it all it takes is one really bad outbreak on a construction site. Someone's not following the guidelines and it might be over. They might have to shut it down.
So I don't, and that's the thing too, when you look at it, kind of at a, when we step back from looking at it just from our industry point of view, I don't know if you guys think of it this way, it's still early days.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Like, we keep on being told that a surge of some kind is still coming. Now, with BC, as you guys reported, we're starting to see a bit more of a flattening. Hopefully that continues. Here, the cases in Ontario are not necessarily leveling off, but they're kind of quiet. But at the same time, the argument is how much testing is actually still happening. Because we've been woefully behind in testing here in Ontario. Like, what are the numbers once we crank it up to full capacity? Because apparently we have the capacity here in Ontario to do 13,000 tests a day if we wished. You know what I mean? If we could manage to do it. So how bad would those numbers be if we're actually doing wider testing, right? So, and you wonder our industry at play in the middle of all this, right? You're right, Russ. It may take just one, you know, really bad outbreak at one site. Well, we've had a couple sites here shut down, but they haven't been, it's been like one worker.
Right.
And not necessarily, they can't say, oh, they contracted it at work. They may have come back from a trip or from a family member, right? So.
Right. And I think what might happen now is you're going to see, like I said, you had the initial shock, and now kind of people's minds are catching up to what's happening, and they're starting to get creative. And I was hearing about road building, and they're like, well, why don't we just do a ton of road building? Like, that's a form of construction where you don't really need a lot of people concentrated in one place. You can be outside and you can, you know, maybe do a ton of road projects and infrastructure projects related to that and keep people working and keep building. And so I think people's minds are starting to spin. They're starting to think of, you know, innovative, creative ways of how, well, how can we still do this? How can we still do that? What's a creative way to do this and that? So I think in the next few months, as this continues to go on, which it's likely to, people are going to get creative and they're going to adapt and they're going to innovate. And it's going to be really interesting to see what people come up with.
It's funny on that point, you talk about the roads. We ran a piece from the Associated Press yesterday. And it was a longer piece looking at road building in the United States. And the conundrum there is, and it plays into what you were saying, it's like there's less traffic because the more people are staying at home. So it's not an ideal time to start doing your road and heavy civil work. But in the U.S., what they're finding, though, because, and I think we could all admit it, we've all been to, like, the highway network system, the network of highways in the U.S. interstates is very impressive, right? Here in Canada, we got, you know, the 401, the Trans-Canada Highway, and then some little offshoots, you got the Yellowhead Pass, and, you know. There you have all these interstates, and a lot of them are dependent on tolls.
Yes.
So they were saying, here's the conundrum. Yeah, we should be able to do more road building. We should be able to get out there. But some states are not going to have the revenue that they would normally collect from the traffic in order to pay for that construction and maintenance.
Correct.
So that's kind of where some of them are stuck. It's like, yeah, we want to do more road work, but not enough people have been using the roads to generate the money so we can afford that project.
Well, in full disclosure, I did used to be a reporter in Washington State, and I heavily covered roads and infrastructure. And the bridges and the road infrastructure in the United States is horrifically maintained. And we even had a bridge in Mount Vernon, near Mount Vernon, where I used to live and report, just fall down and collapse.
Jeez.
Because it just fell into the river. after like, that's the kind of state that some of the bridges and roads in the U.S. are in. And so if there was a massive, I think they get raided by some agency or some like watchdog agency, and they consistently get like a D minus. Like the infrastructure is very, very bad in some parts of the U.S. And there's a ton of work to be done that could be done. If they wanted to put people to work, there are thousands and thousands of bridges that are not up to snuff.
I used to go to New York fairly regularly, and you're instantly struck after going from Toronto with the GO train to New York, and the trains from one of the three airports into Manhattan. You're like, wow, this is really backwards. Like, this is not great compared to Toronto.
Yeah, right. And meanwhile, Torontonians will tell you, having been one my whole life, it's like, our infrastructure sucks. Our transit really stinks. It doesn't get you anywhere.
Well, right? I can both be right. I mean, yeah, it's that right. One turn inside the 401 when you get into downtown, you're like, wow, this needs to be fixed. So stinks. You know exactly which one I'm talking about, I'm sure.
I think you're talking about the DVP turn. Yeah.
Yeah. Where you go right into downtown and there's under a bridge and you're like, this has seen better days.
Yeah. That's true. But so who knows? Maybe that'll be the next story for us, both our publications, the boon, the big heavy civil rush. You know what I mean?
Who's going to crack the code? Who's going to come up with the innovative idea to keep people working, to get people back to work without putting them at risk? Because that's a problem that people can attack, and we'll see how they attack it. And I think that's kind of the next maybe wave of stories, the next wave of things, is you're going to see people, now that they've caught up to this, they're going to start innovating and start getting creative. How can we do this? How can we do that?
Yeah. Well, that's the cool thing. Like, we've seen a little bit, we haven't done the stories yet, but they got past me this week, specifically to our industry, like the millwrights trade. Mm-hmm. They were a couple of reps, both one from BC and one from Ontario, approached me this week about how they've had to retool, how they've chosen to retool what they do as millwrights to help support the healthcare sector.
Right.
And it's not a connection I never would have thought of, you know?
Yeah.
But with their trade, yeah, they can do that. And that's the type of stuff. It's like, I think, like, to your point, Russ, we're going to see more of it, right? You know what I mean? Who's going to crack that code? Because we're seeing other manufacturing, which is kind of a beauty to see the manufacturing sector kind of seeing a bit of a resurgence, at least on an innovation side.
Right.
Specifically here in Ontario, they can be kind of retooling themselves to help the healthcare sector with, you know, making shields, protective masks, and things like that. So,
well, I've written stories about a line painting company that converted their sprayers to spray disinfectant. And I also did a story about there's a vocational trades training college that trains piping apprentices for the piping trades. And they just switched all their training to virtual classrooms. Like, some people are, you know, adapting and innovating, right?
No, it is. And I guess we can just say, you know what I mean, we'll be on top of it. If anybody who's listening to us or reads us has something interesting they want to share, you know what I mean, bring to light as far as an innovation or a connection with the healthcare sector, or if you're donating, like, let Russ Warner, I know.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Just give us a heads up. We can't be everywhere, but
we're not mind readers. No. If you let us know, we'd love to cover it.
Yes. Although I do have an interesting story about donation that I put up a couple of days ago, and this is completely serendipitous. I was just walking past Granville Street, and I saw one of the bars. In fact, most of the bars have plywood on them because they're boarded up, so that, you know, criminals don't try to break in and steal whatever's in there. But there were posters all over the place for Habitat for Humanity saying, "When you're done with this, could you please donate it to Habitat for Humanity?" So I actually called them, found out that the person who came up with this idea was a local club promoter who contacted them and said, "Hey, you know," because he often goes down Granville Street because that's his work most of the time, and said, "What's being done with all this?" And so it turns out that the Habitat for Humanity is getting involved with that, and they're more than happy to take this plywood once it's done. And at the moment, they can't build anything for the very same reason, social distancing and all the rest of it. And they can't open up their, they have a thing called Restore all over the States and here, where you can buy buildings and materials and furniture and whatever else for like 80% off. And so that's kind of getting stocked as this is happening. They've got massive inventory and they're going to put it online, but that's all they can do with it. But they're hoping that that plywood will either go into actual housing or it will go into these restores once the, you know, there's no more need for it and we can open things up again. So it's interesting. It's something I would never could have come across unless I just walked past it.
Fascinating.
That is cool. I mean, yeah, I guess we can kind of wrap it up there, because there is a lot we can talk about. And, you know, if we could only keep our listeners on for so long.
Yes.
All right.
Sorry, guys.
But no. It's with that. Just going to wish you both and all our listeners, too, just stay safe. You know what I mean? Follow the guidelines. We all got to kind of depend on each other in the end to get through this, really. So from Ontario, I'm really got nothing much else to say other than that.
Thanks for listening, everybody.
Yeah, yep. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you. Be well.
This episode of The Construction Record is brought to you by the Greater Toronto Sewer and Water Main Contractors Association. Clean water, our goal, our future.